touching the future today. That's right, today is happening now. We are taking a trip back in time, discovering the mysteries and wonders of the fantastic Los Angeles to Pasadena Metro Gold Line. So sit back and relax and set your watches to now, because we are taking a trip to the future today. Let's ride the Gold Line, train of tomorrow. It all started over 100 years ago. Before the turn of the century, Los Angeles was a vast, arid piece of land with a population of around 2,000. From the first street in Los Angeles, Olvera Street, the city was expanding rapidly because there were forces at work here turning this harsh environment into a desirable and thriving metropolis. The horse and buggy couldn't keep up with the demand of the growing population. The Wild West was over, and the need for mass transit was now. The time had come to get serious about mass transportation in the Southland, and one man had that vision. Henry E. Huntington came to California at the turn of the century with one purpose in mind: to build a transportation empire. He single-handedly bought up all the independent trolley companies, then consolidated them into the Pacific Electric Railroad, which, in the system's peak, packed a whopping 1,164 miles of track, making it the world's largest electrical mass transit system. Ridership wasn't exclusive to the PE. Among the most glamorous trains of yesteryear were Santa Fe's Chief and El Capitan, running from Los Angeles through Pasadena, then to San Bernardino, riding on the beautiful Pasadena subdivision. By the end of the 40s, the love affair with traction was waning. People were driving cars, and many right-of-ways were being bought up by the big three. The PE service slowed, and the declining patronage sealed the fate of the interurbans. By the 50s, the automobile was king of the highway, and electrical mass transit was no longer.
Difficult right now on the 405
freeway northbound. Dyer, earlier accident clears still slow from MacArthur to Dyer.
To Baker, we have an injury crash here on the right
side. Left lane.
The idiot of the 20th century award should go to the person who decided we should sell the red line right away.
What's different in Los Angeles is that it's not a compact city. It's a sprawling city. You have people that live in Pasadena who work in Oceanside, who work in Claremont, people who live on the west side, come into Pasadena. There's just a lot of travel throughout this county.
And it's funny, we're going back to the way the cities used to operate at the turn of the century, almost 100 years ago, where everything was run by rail lines. That's what made Southern California such a desirable place, and real estate boomed for that reason. Now we're going through a whole collapsing, going back into the center. We're already built out to the mountains. Houses are falling into the oceans. I mean, everyone's trying to get away, but the trains are going to connect us again.
I don't believe that simply creating more streets and more highways and more freeways will solve the problem.
What we need to have is a better representation from our independent cities so that the members of the Board of Supervisors and the independent cities will be able to develop a cost-effective regional transportation system.
Prop A was brought to the voters in 1980. It was the first attempt to bring transit dollars for a system that was envisioned for LA County. The city planners took a map of LA County, and it was by this grid that the voters had their first look at the system that they would be buying into.
SB 1847 was the bill that created the authority.
Rick Thorpe was just finishing up the Salt Lake City light rail system targeted for the 2002 Winter Olympics when he was called to head the project.
But this particular project was in the hands of MTA for 15 plus years, and the legislation that created the construction authority mandated that we build it substantially the same way as MTA had planned it.
I think the genius in the construction authority composition was that it is comprised of elected officials from each of the three affected cities whose charter it is to make sure
that the community's best interests are served, and any problems associated with the construction and the operation of the Gold Line are mitigated to the fullest degree possible.
Many officials believed that unless something was done, the new line would never see the light of day. So once again, the greater Los Angeles area was to have another go at a light rail system. With systems already installed at other major metropolitan cities such as Chicago, New York, and London, the developers had about 100 years of catching up to do.
Well, we looked at various ways of getting this project done and concluded design build was the best approach.
Right away, the groundbreaking for the line began, and the workers started springing up all around the cities to start the work. At the same time, the public was being educated about the events that would involve their neighborhoods for the next few years. And there will always be those few individuals out there to contest construction and progress.
We need to have a total commitment where we can revise the laws so that the needs of the public will be met and not a couple of NIMBYs able to be the rock in the stream that creates a serious problem and prevents this type of critical transportation system from being built.
Custom architecture and artwork have been consistent themes throughout MTA's history. Special attention was given to the designing of all stations along the Gold Line system. To accomplish this, the authority hired several artists to establish a visual connection for the 13 stations from LA to Sierra Madre. Built atop two granite blocks, the Astrideside is one such sculpture built into the Mission Street station in South Pasadena. The sculpture's eye-catching scale and dynamic use of human form will be an engaging symbol for a community moving ahead, yet resolutely committed to doing so at its own pace and in its own manner.
Well, I'm the artist who created Astrideside, the sculpture behind us. I'm maybe the last artist to get onto the project, as they understand that about 2 years ago got involved with the first committee meeting and coming up with some proposals and such. I'm actually the first artist to finish, so I'm a really lucky artist.
The late Teddy Sandoval was another artist who was inspired by the beauty of his community and had used architectural details and the landscape to develop a station that would be a gateway to Highland Park.
He envisioned it along the lines of, say, the Watts Towers, where these particular things are the winged figures that will be on top of columns at the station.
Whether you're young or old, riding the Gold Line for business or pleasure, you'll always find the artist's touch at each station pleasing enough to bring you back again and again.
Progress, I mean, we've overcome a lot of hurdles on this project. We're now pretty much into the final stages. You can see behind me, we're starting to take delivery on the vehicles. We're actually starting the testing process. So we're in a transition process right now from construction. Construction is winding down. We'll start testing these vehicles, making sure the system is safe to operate.
Once the testing is complete, all the hard work performed by the construction authority will once again be turned over to the MTA. Pre-revenue testing will begin, which will involve training of drivers, breaking in the vehicles, and working out all the details so the Gold Line will be up and running for the public.
Everything on it is new. You know, it's the new modern streamlined train.
Originally, it was envisioned that the Blue Line would run all the way from Long Beach to Pasadena, but it was realized that an underground connecting terminal under Union Station would be too expensive to construct. So, to make people understand they had to change trains at Union Station, the Pasadena portion was changed from the Blue Line to the Gold Line.
Having this line up and running, and even beyond the line itself, which is going to be so valuable to everyone in this region, the fact that you can build a mass transit project in Los Angeles County on time and on budget, I think is just a tremendous example for the rest of the state.
As the project came winding down, enthusiasm among the local residents grew as they witnessed the project becoming a reality.
Now, phase two of the project is going to be as equally as important as phase one. I mean, if anybody's ever driven on the 210 freeway in the rush hour, you know, you sit and stop and go traffic, and you've got that right of way that's just waiting for light rail. So it's going to be a great project. There's tremendous support from all the cities along the way. There's 11 cities. They're all very excited. The only thing that's really constraining us right now is funding. If we get the funding, we're off and running, and you know, we could open that system tomorrow and probably not have enough cars to put all the people into.
Joint Powers Authority really receives a lot of credit for their oversight, their leadership, and we applaud them for their efforts. So today, this group right here, they are the unsung heroes because they're bringing affordable transportation back to Los Angeles County, and we look forward to expanding these types of programs throughout the next decade so the 21st century will be one of affordable transportation that people can afford that will serve all of the county of Los Angeles, not just a few people downtown.
Could Pasadena survive without the Gold Line? I'm certain it would. But it's going to prosper with the Gold Line because with the system will come additional investment, not only in retail, in office buildings, and in amenities and infrastructure for the city, but residential units as well. So it's going to change the face of downtown Pasadena.
The greatest part about this process is engaging the communities, watching all the artwork surface, seeing people lobby and work for what they felt was important in their neighborhoods.
Impressed with it, they're very happy with it. I think that's been the most exciting and most rewarding part of this project.
In late 2000, the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments and the LA to Pasadena Construction Authority decided to pursue this continuation of the Gold Line east to Claremont and will work together as a team to bring this project to reality. Phase two of the system will play a huge role in redistributing growth and strengthening established downtowns in the foothill communities throughout the San Gabriel Valley.
The air is 70% cleaner today than when I came here in the 1950s. This is a result of projects such as the Pasadena Gold Line, the Red Line, and other public transportation projects.
Light rail transportation has come a long way over the years. The Los Angeles to Pasadena Authority has proven that such systems can be efficiently built to keep people moving along, to help reduce congestion, and to make commuters happy people.
All the projects that I've done over the years in San Diego, Salt Lake, I love to go back and just see them crammed full of people. That's the real justification and excitement about being involved in a project like this.
I'm Roger Steffens. Thanks for watching.
Where bowers of flowers bloom in the spring. Each morning at dawning, birdies sing, and everything a sun kiss misses. Go